Hello, good day, and welcome back. So the last time we were talking about the concurrency pattern, generator concurrency pattern, okay? So we're still talking about concurrency patterns, but today we're going to look at the FanIn concurrency pattern. So what is FanIn? Well, it's a mechanism, I would say, these are my own words, to multiplex multiple inputs into usually one output. Oh, it could be more than one output, but generally, when you fan in, you're going from more to less. So you can go to less number of output than inputs, and therefore you fan in, okay? So in diagram form, it might look like this. You might have several channels, and it doesn't have to be four, just multiple channels, be 100, whatever. But you have multiple channels, and you want to reduce the number of channels to less. And so you're multiplexing those four channels on the left into smaller number of channels. And in this example, I'm showing you one. And so the FanIn pattern we're going to look at, we're going to fan into one. And so if we use our little gopher diagrams that I told you about, our mascot for the Go language, it's going to probably look something like this, where you have these little gophers, your Go routine. Each gopher represents like a Go routine, and it's doing its own thing. And you know, each one of them is going to be generating some data or getting it from somewhere else. So in this example, it looks like they're just speaking, but maybe they're reading data from somewhere else. So maybe they have inputs themselves. But the gopher on the right is our FanIn gopher. And he listens to all the other four gophers, or the ones on his left, and he, whatever they tell him, he puts it out, one after the other, on the channel. He spits it out, right? And it doesn't necessarily mean that he go wrong ribbon, like he waver from one gopher, go to the next, away from that, and da da da. What it all depends on who is doing the most talking and so on, right? As we can see, it's gonna make kind of sense, right? So don't take away like he go wrong ribbon, but just that he takes input from a number of go routines or gophers and then sends it out. All right, so let's go look at the code so we can close this. Even quit this, we don't need this anymore. And so we're in our Go directory, and same thing as usual, we're gonna copy last section code, and we're gonna start with that. And so here's our code from last time, and hopefully it's nice and big so you can see it. And so we had here this generator, okay? And what we said the generator was, you call a function, it returns, it creates a channel, returns right away, and the side effect of that is that the channel is a Go routine that's going to produce some data, which we don't care, we don't see, and so this is our producer here, okay, our generator. Now, what if we were to generate some more data, like we said the last time? So in this example, we're going to generate until C1, C0 through C3, okay? C0 all the way through C3. And so this is kind of boring though, because if you look at our generator, it's generating numbers. Why don't let it generate something that's more interesting? So we're gonna do a string is the thing that it's gonna generate. So it's gonna take a string and it's gonna keep, hello, I'm producer. Okay, for, and then we'll do under producer for S, and then we'll just keep looping around forever, and basically this is a for loop to loop forever, and we're gonna just write out S. So we're just gonna keep sending S, and since it's gonna loop forever, it's never going to end. And we just keep doing that, right? And of course, this can be a channel of int, but a channel of string, okay? And so of course, we gotta make a channel of string, okay? And our consumer is gonna receive channel of string, okay? So let's see. Now these guys need something to generate, so we're gonna say he's gonna generate foo, he's gonna generate who, very creative. Goo. And which I should have started with. Boo. Alright? And so now we have these channels that we're getting data from. And so we want to consume. So one way of consuming from them is to say our consumer, here's C0. Here's C0, C1, C2, and C3. And why don't you just, accept stuff from these guys? And so remember from when we did our variadic function, we could probably do something like that. And we can say, well, okay, this is looping over, selecting, well, let's space them out. So here we don't know what the length of it is. So let's say we know, for example, we have in 0, in 1, in 2, in 3, and they're all of input channels for a string. And so we're going to select, and we're going to try and read a value v from in 0. And of course, if we can read that value, we're not going to print it out. What we want to do is, well, let's print it out for now. And so we're going to print it out. And so let's do this 4 times. So that, 2, 3. Okay. And if we're ever waiting for, we can't read from any of these 4, we're going to think. Now, the way they have it here, where this is just looping and writing, it's never anybody who's going to be, this is never going to be waiting, because these channels are just going to try to write as much as they can, because they're sitting in a loop. What do I have here? Undefined string, okay? And so what we're going to do is let's introduce a delay. And so we know that all we can delay is we can do time.sleep, right? And we want to sleep for a certain duration. Right, so we're gonna sleep for some number of time that that milliseconds for or nanoseconds, or let's do milliseconds, nanoseconds, and this has to be a number. So we could do 2 or something, but that's not gonna make our producer very interesting if we just always sleep all we have 4 of them. So let's make this a random number. So we're going to instead do time that duration and cast that to, and then we're going to put here some rand that int n, and we're going to time that now, which we have done before, that Unix. I don't need that here. And then we're gonna cap this off by, let's say, 5 milliseconds. So between 0 and 4, and then in our main over here, we're going to do ran that seed, and then seed it with, we need a 64-bit, so that's what we can get from time now that Unix, and so we can see Unix return here. So we're going to see the random numbers with the current time when we start running our program. Then we're going to do time that duration and convert what to think. We're going to convert a random number that we get from ran that n5 to a duration, multiply that by milliseconds and think. And so this is supposed to be C3. And so now we look at our code, it's going to run. Now the reason why, because these things are going to run forever and never ever finish, we just want to do this for a few, maybe let's do this for 2 seconds or something, and then watch it quit, or 5 seconds, whatever. That's not a long time. And so cannot use 3, it's not ints. What am I thinking? String and an argument to consume. So 3, 0, is that better? At the bottom here, how many do I have? 1, 2, 3, 4. I have 4. What? I don't trust that wriggly thing. So go run main. And so there we see, it says waiting for thing, then it gives up after a while. And I'm not sure, it doesn't look like we got any data. And let me see why. We should be seeing data from our channel. So let me take this out so there's no random sleeping. And okay, so here's who, boo, and all this other stuff. And you can see that once in a while, we're still kind of actually waiting. We're not getting the data even when we look around. So I think maybe our number of milliseconds maybe was not enough for us to think. So maybe I can do, I don't know, 1,000 and then do like nanoseconds, for example. Okay, we'll see. But anyway, you get the idea. So yep, there we go, right? So I'm waiting a little bit, and we can also see some of my generators are sending some values, okay? And then my program eventually ends. Okay, good. So this is looking good. So we have the generators running, and then we're taking those values, and we're actually multiplying it to the screen, because there's only one output, and so that's what is our consumer is doing. It's reading all these values and then writing it out to one screen. Well, with FanIn, what we really want to do is, instead of it writing it out to the screen, we want to do is it write it out to a channel. So what is the channel is going to write it out to? Well, let's just create a channel called out equals to make a channel of string, right? And so bam, it does that. And so it just takes these values and write it out to out, right? Out. And so let me do this. Right, and so we're no longer going to have it write it to the screen. And maybe it can write this message also, this string, to out also. Why not, if it's waiting, right? Well, what is it gonna do with out? Now, if we call this go routine here in our main and say go run, and this go off and run, and it's sitting here and it's trying to write to this channel out, there's no one, even if we put a buffer, eventually, if we make this a buffer channel, it's still gonna fill up because there's nobody reading from this. So really, what we really wanna do is this guy should return this channel out, right? So we don't have to say go here. We can just say out our result, for example, and then we get it from here, right? But if we call it and it comes here, try to select that thing, it's gonna sit here looping forever and it's never ever gonna return. As you can see, too many arguments, unreachable code, never gonna return. So what we really want this to do is this to be in a go routine. So we wanna say go func, and a channel that doesn't take anything, and this is a function that doesn't take anything. This is our function, and then come on. There we go, and then this is our coroutine. And if this is should reformat, you'll see it's gonna be inserted there. Okay, so why is this out? Let's see, what am I getting there? Oh, cannot use out channel as type string to send. Make channel string. I'm not sure why it's telling me this. when I get the value, that's I need to write it here. Bam, bam. Okay, makes sense. All right, now string to send out on itself. All right, so now this is gonna sit there, read values from the channels that are ready, and then send them. No, I don't care really about default and, you know, saying that, oh, I'm waiting. If I have to wait because none of them are ready, then I have no value to send. But when they're ready, I get those values and I multiplex all the values from them from these different inputs. I multiplex them out to this one channel, okay? And so now we're writing it out. So here in my main, I read from there, I get this result back, but I don't have anything reading that value. So for sometimes, so let's do for, and let's do FMT.println What I want to do, I want to print out, just print out the value. So I'm going to do result, right? But if I do this, I'm going to be just sitting in a loop, reading from this channel and then thing. So what I want to do is I want to time out. So I'm going to do this for a little bit. So I could put this in a go routine itself here. So I could launch a go routine to say go read from this result. So I could say go from, you know, essentially read from this go routine. So it's go routine like crazy. Now once you start understanding them, you could just create go routine like crazy. And so I can launch a go routine to read from my result and print it out to the screen. And then while I'm sleeping back in main, and then main eventually finishes and I close out main. So I just need this to reformat and let's see, command reformat. So this goes with this, this goes with this. So I don't see why it's not reformatting properly, but it essentially looks like this. And now I should be able to run and see my values. So there we go. Oh, what is it? Expected C at the end of a statement. Let's see, where is that coming in? So go func close this. Where's the close parentheses? I'm missing the close parentheses somewhere. Let's see, wait a second. 58 and 60. Okay. Must go. It is a function call. So go func, function that doesn't take any parameters. This is the function, and close in parentheses. So that's a function call. What am I missing? Print line, read from result. What am I missing? Certainly looks good. This is strange. 58. Let's go 58. 58 is somewhere else. Oh, here. Here it's saying I'm missing something. So, syntax error. Expected close parentheses at end unexpected. Why is that unexpected? So I sit here, I do case select. So this is case, okay. Maybe I don't have enough. I think I don't have enough. So I think that's what's happening. So I need one for my select here. Then I need one for my if statement. Then I need one for my go function call. And then I need one for the function. Yep, I had one too few. All right, that's why this guy wasn't being formatted properly. I deleted my closing parentheses when I remove the default. All right, so yep, there we go. It's formatted properly now. All right, so bam, I run that. And wait a second, use as value. Let's see, consumer data, too many arguments to return. So our consumer returns a value. And I did not go and update my consumer to say that it's returned a value. So, which is, it returns a channel of string, right? That's what's returning here, return. So, I need to say that. So this error message should go away in a minute because I'm returning a channel string. Too many messages return. All right, there we go, all right? So notice, if I could pause this, you'll see that I'm getting values from my different producers, and I'm writing them out, and I'm multiplexing them onto the screen. And here it looks like if you get in, you know, foo, goo, hoo, boo, and then, you know, foo is kind of far in between. You get in a lot of boo and goo and foo. But yeah, that's how it's going to run, right? Randomly, sort of, some pseudo-random, because the producers are using pseudo-random number of time to sleep. But what I've successfully demonstrated is that I have been able to multiplex the output from four different channels onto one channel, and that is FanIn. So how my consumer is written now, it is FanIn. And notice how I'm using both my producer and my consumer here, is that I can now even create more than one consumer for those same channels. And Go is gonna take care of, handle all of this scheduling and all this stuff for me because of the use of channels, right? And this Go routine. Like if I have this as result zero, and then I create another consumer like this, passing copies of those same channel, and this is result one. Guess what? This code does not break, because what happens is just two Go routines are now launched to read from these channels, okay? And there are other ways you can write the FanIn also. You don't have to write them this way. You can, the way I've written, and then now, of course, you have two channels that you can read from, but it's up to you if you wanted to do something like that. Let's just simplify it. What I was trying to show you is how Go make this sort of stuff simple. So another way you can write this consumer is to say, you know what, I've made my channel, and instead of doing a select over them, I can actually say, you know, for X, you know, or V colon equals range over, in zero, for example, right? And then put that out on channel, put that value V out on a channel. So let me take this out because I don't have a inner select, right? And I do Go, I created a Go routine to read off of channel zero and write it onto to out, right? And that's a separate Go routine. And then I just do this four times. So it's the same thing. Before I was using a select statement. Here I'm actually, you know, just spinning up a Go routine to read from each one. And instead of writing a Go routine, I could write another function. I could write a function here, and I could simplify this code really. I can actually say that reader, for example, I'm gonna call it reader, colon is equals to a Go func routine that takes the input channel that it should read from. So it takes in channel string, right? And then it should write, so it takes in, and then it reads from that, and then it writes to out, okay? And once I do that, then I don't make the call here, but instead, I go and make the call here instead, and I say Go reader, you take in zero, and you do one, you do two, and then you do three, right? And so I'm launching Go routine on this this function. Of course, the function is an anonymous function stored in this variable, right? And of course, I don't do Go there. That's just a function literal. So I'm doing an anonymous function or a function literal, saving it to a variable, and then I call Go on it, right? Channel string. Oh, that's because here my channel was said only read. It is only for reading. Okay, I can totally just make these channels like that. That's fine. All I need to do is read from them. So, and now I have the same exact thing that I had before, except now we have, like, in this program now we have a ton of Go routine. We have a Go routine that's running main. We have one Go routine that's launched by each one of these generators. So that's 4, 1, 5. Then we have, for this consumer, it creates a channel and launch 4 Go routines on each one of these inputs. So that's another 4. So that's 9. And then, so that's 9 Go routine, and it returns. And then we launch one other Go routine to read the result. So that's 10 Go routine. So notice how many Go routines I have to launch, and I really have to manage them, really, right? Using between channels and the time package, it's getting managed, right? And then, you know, things get cleaned up for me. And this is why I said it, our Go routines are not really threads. They are light threads, and I didn't really cover the details of what a Go routine is, but I did mention that for each program, you can have hundreds of Go routines, okay? And we already have 10 here, and you could just keep going up. All right, and so they get multi-threaded, get scheduled and managed by the runtime that runs your Go application. So let's see if this runs, and it should run the exact same way. Undefined results, line 21. Let's see here, result 0. So take that out, and then now I can run this, and I get the same results, okay? And so this sort of material is actually taken from the reference material I sent you, Go Concurrency Pattern, the talk by Robert Pipe. The example is sort of taken from there, but hopefully I was able to break it down in yet another way that you can understand with a little bit more details. But I'd say between that and my video, you should be able to, between one of those two should allow you to understand it. If you still have questions, please let me know and I'll try another way, yet another way. Now, I showed you here, you're taking four individual parameters, but you can imagine taking like a slice of channel or doing variadic parameters and just looping over that and creating, you know, just looping over an array or a slice of channel and then just spinning up the Go routine here, for example, right? Because once you have the animals function here, now is just sitting in a loop here and spinning these up. So you can see that this FanIn function could really scale to handle a wide number, much larger number of inputs. All right, so you can make it more scalable. All right, I want to cut this off here. Been pretty long video already. So again, thanks for your time. Thanks for subscribing. Thanks for the support. Keep spreading the word. And if you haven't subscribed, please do. And I do appreciate you taking your time to come and check out my video. Take care. See you in the next video.